Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2022. Delighted we have our Deputy Convener, David Torrens, back with us this morning, who's been absent for a few meetings. And we have a busy session this morning. We have three evidence sessions on three very important issues. Later we're going to be joined by a Golden Eagle, who has come specially along to not give evidence, but certainly to evidence one of our petitions that we'll be discussing this morning. Agenda item one, just to confirm with colleagues that we will take items 4, 5 and 6 and private later on. You're content with that, colleagues?
Yeah,
fine, thank you. Agenda item two is consideration of continued petitions. The first of these is petition 1900, which is access to prescribed medication for detainees in police custody, and was lodged by Kevin John Lawson. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all detainees in police custody can access their prescribed medication, including methadone, in line with existing relevant operational procedures and guidance. Now, colleagues will recall at our last meeting, we heard evidence from David Strang, who's the former chair of the Scottish Drug Death Task Force. I gather he's now part of the implementation group, he was able to say. And Carol Hunter, who was also a former member of that task force. And our discussion with them has informed some of the areas that we would like to just explore on this morning's meeting. So we are joined this morning, delighted to say, by the Minister for Drugs Policy, Angela Constance, MSP. Good morning to you, Minister.
Good morning.
And her officials from the Drugs Policy Division of the Scottish Government, Maurice Fraser, Head of Delivery and Support, and Henry Akers, Head of Culture and Structural Change. So good morning to both of you as well. You're most welcome. Thank you all for coming. Now, we can move straight to questions, or if there's anything you would like to say just by way of introduction or clarification, we'd be very happy to hear.
Well, Convener, firstly, thank you for inviting me along this morning. This is my first appearance at this particular committee in my capacity, anyway, as Minister for Drugs Policy. And I do want to start by thanking the committee and the petitioner for the work that they have done in this matter. Access to treatment, the right treatment at the right time for each and every person, it's at the very heart of the national mission, and I support the aims of this petition, and I agree that people detained in police custody must have access to their prescribed medication, and that includes medication-assisted treatment such as methadone.
Thank you very much. I suppose, given that we heard from David Strang and Dr. Carol Hunter last week, what is the Scottish Government's reaction to the Scottish Drug Deaths Task Force's report, Changing Lives, because it included quite a comprehensive suite of recommendations? Will the Scottish Government be publishing a plan in relation to those recommendations? And by the end of January next year, that'll be 6 months since the publication of the report. I mean, I recognise there's an implementation group, but what is your reaction to it, and how do you intend to summarise the way that you expect to move forward?
So at the time, I very much welcomed the task force report. Indeed, I had been looking forward to receiving their vital recommendations. At the turn of the year, we will publish our full response to the task force. They have indeed made a suite of recommendations, very comprehensive recommendations, 20 recommendations, but with 139 action points. So we will bring forward our full response at the start of the year. And I should say, in terms of subject committees, we gave an initial response that went to health and social care, justice, and I think also the social policy committee as well. So we have, you know, given Parliament some indication of the direction of travel, but the culmination of our response will be presented to Parliament at the turn of the year.
Thank you very much. And yes, as you paid tribute to the work of the petitioner beforehand, it's obviously been a very difficult personal situation that led to the petition that came before us. And it identified issues, some of which I think in our correspondence with the government were accepted as being areas that perhaps merited a little bit of further work and explanation. And I have to say, I think obviously we were very impressed with the evidence we heard last week, because the experience of both David Strang and Dr. Carol Hunter was significant and therefore did underpin a very informed discussion. Obviously, our job is in relation to the issues raised within the petition. And I'm going to let David Torrance turn first to the specific issues that arise from that. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to other witnesses. Minister, how important do you feel it is to embed the medication-assisted treatment standards in practice, especially with regard to ensuring that individuals receive appropriate medication while in police custody?
So there's 2 points there, Mr. Torrance. In terms of the more global point about the implementation of medication-assisted treatment standards. They are vital. They are a big platform of the government's reform programme. This is about ensuring that people have quick access to treatment, that they have informed choice about their treatment, that services are planned and operate in a way that they are anticipating people's needs, and that as well as quick access to evidence-based treatments, that all of that is connected to both mental health and primary care. So the MAT standards is crucial and vital, and they are not optional. Members will be aware of the statement I made to Parliament earlier this year, and I will be making a further statement to Parliament next week. In terms of the specific issue about the prescription of medicine, of opiate substitution therapy, and in this case, police custody settings, MAT Standard 3 requires people's treatment to be provided to them irrespective of their setting. OST, you know, needs to be routinely available to those who it is prescribed to in custodial settings for MAT Standard 3 to be met. Now, all health boards and ADPs and IGBs have accepted the importance and the shared agenda that we all have to the implementation of MAT standards. We continue to... The issues raised by the petitioner and committee, we, of course, been engaging with various police and healthcare networks, the police care network, and to the best of my knowledge, the only place where this appears to be an issue has been the one that's been identified in Elgin. But I want to be clear, the guidance is clear, MAT standards are clear about what should happen. And in my view, as Minister for Drugs Policy, any interruption of a person's medical treatment is utterly unacceptable because of the consequences in which the committee is well aware of. This interruption of someone's medical treatment, in my view, is discriminatory, and it is just not acceptable. And ultimately, the implementation of MAT standards will resolve this issue where it exists, and as it says, it appears to be a specific issue to Elgin. But I hope I can convey to committee in the strongest terms that this, in my view, is discriminatory where it exists, and that we treat drug and alcohol problems as a health condition. And drug and alcohol treatments have to be on a par with any other treatment for any other condition.
Thank you, Minister. Around the implementation of MAT standards, the Scottish Drugs Deaths Task Force recommend that MATs be embedded by May 2024. Urge the Scottish Government, of course, to meet this, and if not, how much work is there still to be done?
So there's a lot of work to do. There is a lot of work ongoing. Members will be aware of the ministerial direction that I issued in June this year, because I was not content with the scale and pace of progress. Part of the purpose of my statement to Parliament next week is to reflect on the information that all areas have provided in terms of their improvement plans. All areas are subject to regular reporting on progress. For most areas, that's quarterly, but for areas with particular difficulties, that's monthly. And the other part of the purpose of my statement next week is to inform Parliament of the government's view of the recommendations, not just in relation to the task force on this matter, but the Public Health Scotland benchmarking report that was published in June this year.
No further questions.
Okay, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning.
In the submission that the Scottish Government put back in March this year, you were committing to consulting with Justice and Health to establish the best methods of recording how many requests for prescribed medications had been made for those individuals within custody and whether these requests had been met. So can I ask from that, can the Minister give us an update on to any progress that has been made within that area to ensure that that is the case?
So, thank you, Mr. Stewart. So it is an area that we've been given considerable thought to. Certainly my initial response to inquiries from committee, that I understood why committee was raising this issue on what could be a potential gap in information. And part of the underpinning evaluation of our national mission to save and improve lives is to ensure that we have the right measurements in place. And ultimately, and I won't repeat what I've said about MATMAT standards, ultimately issues such as these are resolved through the delivery of MAT standards. But it appears to me that, and if I could just take a slight step back from the question just by way of context, is that we publish a lot of information around OST, you know, number of people in treatment, you know, there's a whole range of information already published by Public Health Scotland. And what we, you know, and committee is well aware of, you know, information being held in terms of prescription and healthcare at a local level. But it is the case that in terms of Police Scotland, in terms of their national custody records, so this information is actually available, but it's within Police Scotland systems. So we are given some thought about that. There are task force recommendations more broadly about ensuring that our healthcare and justice systems speak to each other, and there are some other important recommendations about information sharing. Now, in terms of information that's held with a statutory organisation such as Police Scotland, you know, there are particular, you know, complexities around unravelling this. But I am aware that His Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland have access to a range of information held by Police Scotland. So I am contemplating whether, you know, that is a potential route, you know, whether I as Minister should, you know, engage with the Inspectorate. I don't know if it's something that committees considered, because this information is available to the Inspectorate in terms of the inspections they have done. And indeed, they have, I think it was this time last year, did an inspection that involved the Elgin custody suite as well. And they made a number of recommendations around that, which I'm informed have led to increasing the nursing provision for the custody, and that there's now full-time nursing cover for that centre.
In reality, there may well have been that gap, Minister, that was identified, and you've now indicated that through other resources or through other ways of managing that, the gap may then be closed, because that's what we're trying to identify. If the gap exists, and it would appear the gap does exist, ensuring that everyone is then given and supported during that custody situation.
So actually, I think it's not so much a gap in information, it's the availability and the transparency of that information at a national level, because actually, in terms of the information that's available about what happens within police custody, there's actually, and in terms of the prescription of OST, there's actually more information available or more information gathered in police custody settings than there are in other settings. And that goes back to the nub of the issue of all the information we publish in and around OST. We have lots of information around where it is dispensed, you know, where it's dispensed from, you know, whether that's hospital or pharmacy. We have much less information about where it is administered. Mm-hmm. So the information that's available in a police custody setting, or the information that's gathered, is much greater than, say, you know, perhaps maybe homeless settings where there are in-reach, you know, medical provisions.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. So, I was interested and I was going to pursue myself, because you started by saying you thought the incident in Elgin was isolated to the particular example mm-hmm. that had been raised through the petition. And I was unclear why you thought that, but by explanation, although the information isn't publicly transparent, it is there, and therefore you have been able to satisfy yourself through the availability of the information that Police Scotland has that it hopefully was just an isolated example. And therefore, in response to the committee, when you said the Scottish Government was giving consideration to it, it's not that you're giving consideration to a wholly new process because you believe the information is there. It's consideration to how that information, which is currently not necessarily available or demonstrably available for people to see, could be more transparently there so that people can see that, in fact, the prescriptions have actually been prescribed. Is that essentially correct?
So I think that's an accurate submission, convener, in terms of the information that is currently gathered, that's Police Scotland information. In terms of me satisfying myself about what's happening on the ground, the major stream of work of that is around the implementation of MAT standards. So we have a lot of granular information about what's happening at a local level. Colleagues may be aware of supplementary information that was published in August of this year that is really given an area-by-area breakdown and where individual areas are in terms of MAT standards. We are through what we call the MAT Standard Implementation Support Team, MIST, and we're providing real practical hands-on support to local areas in terms of, you know, how to better gather information, how to change the ways in which they are working, you know, fully cognizant of the need to challenge, you know, stigma, discrimination and culture. We have improvement plans in from all areas. We have this quarterly reporting and in some cases monthly reporting. So through the serious and significant endeavours to implement MAT standards, treatment standards, we have much more information at a local level that gives us that real connectivity, I think, that we've not had before between government and actually communities.
That's great. Thank you very much. Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I prefaced my question by pointing out that I'm not, of course, a clinician, but I did want to raise an issue which was referred to in evidence, namely that there was some concern that in Grampian there has been a prescription of dihydrocodeine, and we had some concerns about the appropriateness of this. So I did take the opportunity of asking Dr. Hunter in the last evidence session about this, and she said, and I quote, dihydrocodeine is sometimes prescribed in custodial settings as guidance on exceptional circumstances within the UK guidance that I mentioned. Its prescription should not be routine as a replacement, but there are some exceptional circumstances, including when it's not possible to get access to existing prescribed medication safely, in which it would be used by an experienced clinician. Now, to be fair, I think we are seeking a response from NHS Grampian, as is only right and proper, about this matter. I'm not sure that we've got that yet, but I just wondered if I could raise this with you and ask what is the Scottish Government's view about the use of dihydrocodeine, and is there something which should be minimised so that by ensuring the availability of, for example, methadone, which I imagine would be the normal opiate substitute that is prescribed in most cases, at least in accordance with my understanding. So without really casting any aspersion or blame to NHS Grampian, I just wanted to raise the general issue with you, Minister, today to see what the Scottish Government's view is about this, because it was raised, I think, by the petitioner or others in evidence.
OK, thank you. Like you, Mr Ewing, I'm not a clinician, but you've had the evidence from Dr Carol Hunter, who is a senior pharmacist of many years standing, and you know she's given evidence to that effect. This is an issue, or one of the issues, that I have written to NHS Grampian about. So in terms of the specific point in and around dihydrocodeine, it's while prescribers can make judgments on a case-by-case basis, you know, based on you know clinical judgment and health and safety. But the bottom line is, as I understand, as a non-clinical person, and in accordance to the guidance, I think the guidance is pretty clear, both the UK-wide guidance that Dr Hunter referred to and also the guidelines for Police Scotland and healthcare professionals, that the routine use of alternatives, such as dihydrocodeine, does not meet the required level of support for MAT standards and should only be used in exceptional circumstances and not routinely. So that is what I have stated in my correspondence to NHS Grampian, and essentially that is a reiteration of the guidance. I have also, convener, just for information, in terms of the broader context of my correspondence to NHS Grampian, I have written to them, I mean, in fairly direct terms, saying that it has come to my attention, I am aware, I believe, that the still, despite the long-standing nature of this issue, still do not routinely provide OST in all circumstances. And it's that issue about routinely. Yes, there are exceptional circumstances that Dr. Hunter spoke to, but they should be in a position to routinely provide OST and not be disrupting people's medication. So I have asked NHS Grampian if that is the case, and if that is the case, when and what are they going to do to remedy it? And I would be happy to share that letter with committee convener if that was helpful, and obviously the response that I receive in due course.
Thank you. Mr. Ewing?
Well, that predicted the question I was going to ask, which is, could you please let us know what response you get from NHS Grampian? They obviously must have an opportunity to respond and give their view, and that's only fair and proper. But I think our job, or part of our job, is to make sure that the petitioner's plea for the availability of prescription of opiate substitutes, principally methadone, I guess, is being properly, thoroughly analysed and responded to by this Parliament. That's our job. So I'm very keen to see the results of the inquiries. I'm very pleased that, Minister, you have already made and pursued vigorously. So thank you for that.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for your points so far. A key aspect that was discussed in a previous evidence session was the risks associated with release from custody, and particularly the Friday release practice. And of course, the Changing Lives report has recommended that this be banned as expeditiously as possible. Can the Minister give an update on where the government is with progressing that?
So this is a feature in the Bail and Release Custody Bill that is at stage one. I've been a long advocate of ending Friday liberations. And actually, I would contend that It's not that it doesn't, it just doesn't make sense to me. And I appreciate that there are, you know, significant operational issues for the Scottish Prison Service to consider in and around all of this. But when I, you know, think of my time as a prison social worker, admittedly it was a long, long time ago now, that, you know, releasing, you know, large numbers of people on a Friday because people can't be liberated on, you know, a Saturday or a Sunday, you know, can often lead to people not being liberated to later in the day. And as much as people's care arrangements should be in place before they're liberated, and I think that's part of the purpose also of the justice legislation that the Cabinet Secretary is taken through, there are practical issues that people have to contend with on the first day of release, and it doesn't make sense to do that on a Friday, because if there are any challenges in that, people can therefore be waiting till the Monday. And I think we have to look at the evidence and follow the evidence that any period of transition, any change, comes with its risks. And we know that people being released from custody is a period of elevated risk. So we need to be planning for that to mitigate the risk and at a very common sense level. You know, Friday liberations don't make sense.
A key point made by Dr. Carol Hunter in relation to this practice was the support of the pharmacy network in Scotland, and particularly around seven-day access. Has the Minister got a view about how the pharmacy network could support the infrastructure for releasing prisoners from custody, particularly looking at potential changes in doses where people have been in a custody setting to then managing their medication outside?
So, in general, I would agree that community pharmacies are an underutilised resource. The task force have made some interesting recommendations around a sort of enhanced service contract. There are some parallels with that in terms of arrangements with GPs and primary care. There are 1,250 pharmacies in Scotland. That's quite an extensive network that we could be, you know, tapping into. There are, there's of course, you know, innovative and progressive use and helpful use of pharmacist services, you know, in different parts of Scotland. But there's a network there. There's expertise there that we need to be making more use of. It is imperative that we're making use of all the assets at our disposal, and community pharmacy is very much part of that.
Another key point in relation to the support from a pharmacy network, or more generally, was naloxone, and particularly ensuring that people released from custody are provided with naloxone, or those who are caring for them or have a support network. The evidence provided previously has indicated this is a patchy practice. What is the Minister doing to ensure this is more of a standard protocol?
So actually I think there's good progress being made in terms of increasing the distribution of take-home naloxone kits. There was figures published, I think it was either Monday or Tuesday. And these are quarterly figures. So there is around 6,500 naloxone kits, you know, distributed. That's in terms of take-home naloxone kits. And then, you know, members can refer to these published figures at their leisure, but it gives a breakdown of the settings in which they come from, and that includes prisons. And it includes, you know, kits dispensed by community pharmacies also, and also the Scottish Ambulance Service. In terms of ADPs that have a prison within their catchment, there are 13 ADPs that have a prison in their local area, and 85% of them have very specific arrangements made with their community justice partners, and that's about, you know, identifying risks. And part of that is issuing of naloxone. And there's good use in some cases of peers in terms of, you know, peer networks, you know, people with lived experience who are now in recovery, you know, going into prison settings and supporting people in terms of training and the take home naloxone kit. And the other statistic that we monitor, I hate talking about statistics in this fashion, Convener, because at the end of the day we're talking about lives. But there's a national naloxone programme in Scotland, and it is the reach of that programme continues to increase, and we continue to monitor that. And it's estimated that 66 people out of every 100 who are at risk of opioid overdose have been provided with a take-home naloxone kit. So naloxone is very important. It's just one part of the solution in terms of a whole system of care and treatment and support. But I believe that we're making progress, but we need to continue on the trajectory.
Just one final question, if I may, Convener. A key part of that wider support network that was discussed was in supporting people releasing from custody. Referrals to supervised overdose prevention facilities was highlighted as a key measure to reduce harm in that period, going from obviously a supervised setting to an unsupervised setting. And obviously cognizant of the potential Glasgow pilot in this regard, could the Minister provide an update on the progress with the Glasgow pilot, potentially the interaction with local custody settings as a mechanism for referring people who might be vulnerable to that pilot facility?
Sure, and Mr Sweeney knows my enthusiasm for safer drug consumption facilities, and we are doing everything to leave no stone unturned to achieve the goal of a pilot site in Glasgow within our powers. The short answer is, Convener, is that the Crown Office are now in a position to give advice to the Lord Advocate. As you know, I can't speak on behalf of either the Crown Office or the Lord Advocate, but we have, along with our partners in Glasgow, done extensive work on this and have pursued it to the nth degree. It's not the silver bullet, but it's one piece of the jigsaw, and given the scale of the challenge we face in Scotland, we need all the bits of the jigsaw.
Just a very quick supplementary.
Well,
okay.
I think we have strayed a little bit out with the terms of the petition which the Minister is here to discuss. But
it was just to bring it back to the point about the interaction between custody settings and this potential pilot. Is there going to be a definite link?
I think the broad point that Mr Sweeney makes, whether this is in relation to safer drug consumption facilities or any other service, is the connectivity between services. And actually, to go back to your petition, one of the improvements in and around the Elgin custody suite is that they do have systems in place where they are informing the local service when people are brought into custody and when they're on an OST script, and then they are being informed, local services are being informed when people are being released. The issue, I think, where we're all concerned about is what happens in that period while someone's in custody, and are they or are they not getting their medically prescribed treatment, which they are entitled to and under no circumstances should be disrupted unless there are exceptional issues in and around health and safety.
Okay, thank you. And I just, it occurred to me, just as a very final thought, in relation to the availability of healthcare staff, obviously, in the wider political context, we are, discussing the pressures that there are upon the resource of staffing. Are you, as Minister, aware of any data or any issues currently around the availability of staff to ensure that prescribed medicines are able to be safely delivered to those who are in custody when that is appropriate?
So in terms of the broad point you raise about that, obviously it is beholden on health boards and IGBs to be monitoring this, and in terms of their routine reporting structures, they can obviously raise and do raise workforce issues with the government and with NHS Scotland more broadly. In terms of the work that myself and drugs policy officials are pursuing in terms of the implementation of MAT standards, there is a financial resource attached to the implementation of MAT standards. And when I spoke to committee before summer recess, I had said that there was around 100 posts that were going to be funded. That figure has increased, and to be specific and more helpful, I know that in terms of Murray, where Elgin Custody Centre is, that in terms of the staff that they have recruited in and around MAT standards, that they have been, you know, successful in that. And similarly, Aberdeenshire has sought a number of staff and have been largely, you know, successful in that as well. So I'm not disputing that there are workforce issues, but there are examples of where those have been overcome, either through additional resource to help the recruitment of staff or with the redesign of services.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, I've not been ignoring your officials. I just assumed you would bring them in if you felt there was anything appropriate that they would be able to say. I think, has been very helpful in relation to the issues we've been exploring with our petition minister. Is there anything further you would like to say to us just in conclusion?
No, just to say that I very much appreciate committee digging into this. Very often when we have debates in chamber or other committee appearances that I've been obliged to do. But because drugs policy can really be considered in isolation, there have been very broad ranging debates. So actually it's been very useful and very helpful to take a specific issue in a specific locality and bore down into the details. So thank you for that.
Yeah, thank you. And of course, it's one of the advantages of the Petitions Committee. We are taking forward the issues of an individual with a petition rather than bringing forward individual party political considerations, which sometimes allows us to have quite a meaningful conversation about the particular issue in hand. So thank you very much for your appearance with us this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll now suspend briefly. Just members, before I do, you're content we consider the issues that we've raised in the evidence this morning at a later date. Then we'll just suspend briefly. Thank you. Back, and our second evidence session this morning is in relation to petition number 1928, which is to provide free rail travel for disabled people who meet the qualifications for free bus travel. And this has been brought for us by David Gallant. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide free rail travel for disabled people who meet the qualifications for free bus travel. Now, we last considered this petition at our meeting on the 20th of April this year, when we agreed to write to Transport Scotland seeking an update on the Fair Fares Review, and a copy of their response, colleagues, has been included in our meeting papers for today. And at that meeting, we also agreed to hear evidence from the petitioner and Cite Scotland. And so I'm pleased to welcome our petitioner, David Gallant, good morning, and Nicoletta Primo from Cite Scotland to today's meeting. And pleasure to have you both with us. Not always we have the petitioner present when we're able to consider our petitions, so it's helpful that you are both here today. Members will have a number of questions they would like to explore, but we understand that you would both like to say a few words, and I'm very happy. I think the clerks will have told you it can't be longer than a speech in the chamber, but we're looking forward to a few words from each of you. And I don't know, as either of you, have you drawn straws as to who's going to speak first? David, you're going to speak first. Good morning and welcome.
There are many voluntary organisations have supported this petition, though I don't understand why Transport Scotland objects. Due to inflation, the scheme will now actually save money rather than cost money. I'm sure you'll be pleased to hear that. With regard to the rules of the free rail travel for disabled people, it's important that rail travel should follow the same rules as bus travel as far as possible. Bus travel is allowed as far as Berwick-upon-Tweed and Carlisle. Those travelling from Lockerbie to Gretna Green or Annan should be able to change trains at Carlisle rather than have to travel via Glasgow. So it's important that Carlisle should be included. It is included in bus travel. It's also important that Carlisle should be included for rail travel, even though it's not in Scotland.
Okay. Thank you. That's what you wish to say to us in advance, yes? Yeah, thank you. And very happy to hear from you now as well. Thank you, Nicoletta.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'd like to thank the committee for inviting Cite Scotland and Cite Scotland veterans to provide evidence on this petition. I'd also like to extend a thanks to David Gallant for bringing this important issue to the Parliament. Cite Scotland and Cite Scotland veterans are two of Scotland's oldest charities. We are dedicated to ensuring that nobody should face sight loss alone. There have been some elected members here today who will be aware of our Fail Rail campaign. This has one very simple call: to provide free rail travel for the companions of those who hold a national entitlement card with the I and the plus one symbol on it. Currently, there is no national policy that entitles companions for free rail travel. That only exists for bus policy, and it is our view that this should also extend to rail travel as well. As a result, on today's petition, I will be largely speaking from the perspective of those who are blind and partially sighted and their experiences of using the rail network, and I welcome any questions that the committee might have regarding this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to let Mr. Paul Sweeney lead the questioning on this petition.
Yep.
Mr. Sweeney.
Can I ask, obviously, this current provision for bus travel, why is extending this to include rail travel so important?
Speaking from, if you don't mind, David, I can answer first. Speaking from the perspective of those who have a visual impairment, quite often using the rail or using rail travel will be much more accessible. We have heard from veterans in particular who have said access to platforms, to toilets, can just be a lot easier to use through the rail network as opposed to having to use it on a bus, particularly for longer journeys. We've also heard from a single mother that we support, and she's spoken of that as well. When she's travelling with her daughter, it's so much easier for her to be able to use a train as opposed to have to use a bus, and particularly around the needs for companion travel. There's some people that just simply would not be able to use the rail system without having somebody with them. And we've heard that quite often they would prefer to use the train, but due to costs, they simply can't afford it. and instead they're deciding to use the bus instead. So there's many benefits as to why this should be extended nationally, as opposed to just having currently the situation for companion travel is very much around each local authority has a different system in place. Some offer a concessionary rate for companions, some don't. And even the ones that do, it's not always enforced properly. So it's causing quite a lot of confusion, not just for passengers, but for rail staff as well.
Thanks for that. And particularly, I was interested by the submissions from Transport Scotland were referring to the disabled person's rail card. You might have actually already have hinted as to why that is insufficient. Perhaps is that why it's insufficient, because of this lack of companion travel arrangement?
The companion element is a particularly important part, and it's something that Sight Scotland particularly has picked up upon. The reason being is that for many people, travelling by yourself simply isn't an option. If you have mobility issues or you've got sight loss issues or other sensory issues, having a companion with you can mean the difference of travelling or not at all. And we found that people have said, because I can get on the bus with my companion, and there's the element there that's provided for, they'll rather use that than use the train. But in terms of reliability, accessibility, they would much rather use the rail system, but it's simply just not affordable to them.
That's very helpful. I understand currently the disabled bus travel concessionary scheme is about 78% of those disabled who use it have a companion allowance. So it does seem like a major aspect of using that scheme.
Yes, it's very, very significant. And I think that having such a high percentage of users who are using the companion element of it is evidence that it is necessary and it's needed. And if we have it for the bus system and we know it works and we know it's used, it makes sense to then extend that nationally on the rail system as well, particularly since ScotRail is now under public ownership. It should be there for everybody to use, and that means meeting the needs of all of those in society.
If I may, convener, I think I'd be interested to know what costings you might have developed around this. I understand you hinted that they would save money. I was intrigued by your point.
Yes, the Scottish Government has no power to control bus fares, as far as I know, and bus fares have been going up. So the more people that transfer from bus to rail, it will actually save money because the Scottish Government have to pay 76% of the single fare to bus operators. And with bus fares going up, it would be actually save money to encourage more people to travel by train.
Thanks for that. Have you any idea of the total numbers of people who might utilise such a scheme in Scotland? Just out of interest, just to get an idea of the scale relative to the overall passenger cohort of people in Scotland.
From those who hold the NEC card with the I and the plus one symbol, or just the I symbol, you're looking at the costings for that would be around about £2 million. However, we have had discussions or are in discussions with Transport Scotland for more specific data on that, because that is just an estimate. So from that cohort of people, it would be around, I think it's about 55,000, but I would need to double check that, but I'm happy to send the committee that final figure.
I think we actually have, sorry.
Have you got my briefing, maybe,
yeah,
perhaps?
So there is, it's around overall about 146,000 people. Though if you break it down into different components, disabled plus companions, about 105,000. So that's helpful. I suppose what we'd then ask is that there's a potential split about the point made about bus travel versus rail travel, but potentially a lot of journeys are actually highly integrated. So you actually need to do a bus, then a train travel. So is there an element of this which would help make it more seamless for people with a visual impairment just to navigate the transport system more generally? Is that...
Do you want to speak, David?
I personally find it impossible to use the toilets on long... I live in a rural... I should explain that I live in a rural area of Scotland, a long way from any big cities. And I personally find it impossible to use the toilets on long-distance buses. But I can use them on trains.
Okay. Can I ask, I mean, the information we have in relation to companion travel is that there are some authorities, Fife Council, West Lothian Council, Strathclyde Passenger Partnership for Transport, who offer a 50% reduction for companion travel. And I wondered whether there is any evidence you're aware of whether that in itself has made any difference to the incidence of companion travel in those local areas.
There isn't any specific data gathered on that. However, anecdotally, we have heard that that discount system is utilised and it's greatly needed. But we want to see that go further and for that to be mimic the bus system where that is free. I think that because, as David has rightly pointed out, there's differences in rural areas and urban areas in terms of who is using rail versus bus. And yourself pointed out, Mr. Sweeney, that there is also the elements here of integration, particularly if you're thinking about, you know, looking at the National Transport Strategy that talks heavily around about integration between different modes of transport. And I think that in instances where there is a companion discount, the issue being is that it's not always enforced. So sometimes we're hearing that people will get on at certain stations and be told, yes, you can get on for a discount, or there's no need to pay this time. And then other times they're being forced to pay the full fare. And it's simply confusing for people. So in fact, not having a national policy and having each local authority, or in SBT's case, covering many local authorities, is actually causing confusion and sometimes putting people off, because they just don't know whether that companion discount is going to be actually applied at that time or not, because there's no clear policy as to whether it is on that day or not that day, when really somebody is entitled to it.
Okay, thank you. And for that, maybe something we as a committee can try and pursue a little bit further and just find out how these schemes exist, what the uptake is, and what education there has been in relation to an understanding of them amongst both rail travellers and rail staff. You mentioned, Mr. Gallant, that you live in a rural community, and I think Alexander Stewart's going to touch on that.
Thank you very much indeed for coming. You talk about the rurality, but is it not the case that in some situations and circumstances there are opportunities to develop some process? And can I ask you about, you know, the review you've had at the moment? Has there been any consultation, or have you had any feedback into the Fair Fares Review? Because that's what the Scottish Government are putting together at the present moment, to look at the concessionary aspects of all of that. And would you or have you had any consultation or involvement with that Fair Fares Review?
It's not a question of fares. It's a question of disability discrimination. I simply can't travel on long-distance buses because the toilets on long-distance buses provided by companies like CityLink and Stagecoach Megabus are simply not suitable, whereas the toilets on trains are suitable for persons with my disability.
And have you had any involvement with the review, Nicoletta?
Yes, we have. South Scotland has responded to the Fair Fares Review, and we've made the points that I mentioned this morning. I'm not aware of any sort of update or any report back from that. Obviously, we look forward to hearing what that says. I think what I would stress is, though, is that I think this is something that can be implemented ahead of that review. I don't think that review necessarily needs to be the catalyst in which this change happens. It's quite possible that this could be implemented, particularly for, I'm specifically here talking about companion travel for those with sight loss, through statutory instruments. So there is scope there for that. Just coming back to your previous point, Convener, I'd like just to add, you mentioned there around having different schemes in different places. And I'd maybe just like to sort of pick up on a quote that I have from one of our service users, which is, my travelling companion can travel for free on some trains in Scotland, but it depends on which local authority they're signed up to. The problem is this has led to not but a few arguments of train employees and local, as not all local authorities are signed up. You can start your journey in a participating area but end up in a non-participating one, and a train company employee can insist the companion pay and buy a ticket on arrival. This has happened to me frequently. It is a recipe for anguish and anxiety. And I think that stresses the point even further, that even though there are some schemes in place that do offer a discount, not having a national consistency in it is really causing people quite a lot of confusion, and also real staff confusion as well.
Thank you. Obviously, this is something we can explore. I'm just trying to understand that, because it's a 50% reduction, so presumably they would still have a ticket.
So normally what happens is if you are at the barrier and you've got your national entitlement card, as a card holder, you will go through that barrier. Yes. However, the person that's with you, they sometimes can just go through with the other person and there's no ticketing system in place. Or the person is then having to go to a ticket office in order to purchase a ticket. However, not all train stations obviously have ticket offices, and there's no option on the automated ticket machines to select a companion travel for the discount. So it sometimes isn't always possible for a person to actually even obtain a ticket.
To access the actual benefit that exists.
Exactly. Right.
Because, I mean, the bit I was slightly confused at is it's not a free ticket, it's a 50% reduction.
Exactly.
So I would have expected them still to have a ticket, so that irrespective of where their journey ended, they would have been able to present the ticket they'd purchased.
They sometimes, often, I can't even purchase the ticket at the discounted rate in the first place, unless they're at a station where there is, say, a barrier, the person shows their card and they go through. So... And as I said, there's no option on that machine to select companion discount. So sometimes that ticket in itself is simply...
So are they then getting on the train not having paid any fare at all?
Quite possibly, but then at the other end, they would then have to ensure that they paid. And that's when they come to the point of, can we get the discount or not?
And then they're now trying to obtain the discount at the end of the journey where they're participating, whether it's a non-participatory authority. I understand.
Yes.
Mr Ewing.
Hey, thank you, Convener. Good morning to both of our witnesses, and thank you for coming along. And I think, if I may say so, Mr. Gallant, you make a very strong case for the extension of concessionary travel to people with a disability, both on the grounds of equity and on the grounds of avoiding discrimination. So I just wanted to say that, and I do hope the Scottish Government will respond sympathetically following this review. I wanted just to ask about one point that you raised, I think before the petition was lodged, which was you explained that the cost of providing free rail travel for disabled people could easily be met by raising the starting age for free bus travel for senior citizens from 60 to 61. And I must say, I think that seems to be a suggestion that I hope, again, the Scottish Government will consider. I'm fortunately or unfortunately, I'm 65, so for the last 5 years I've been entitled to a free bus pass. I've never taken it up, but I'm a bit puzzled as to why myself, as a fairly well-paid person, should need this support, quite frankly, on the grounds of equity. And frankly, I'd far prefer that people with a disability had access to rail travel than people who are able to afford their own costs of public transport should do so themselves. But now that I've got that off my chest, because I think there's a very strong rationale. I know that, without revealing secrets, that the Scottish Government did consider this at my instigation before, but it didn't actually end up with anything happening. So there we are. But
there's a plenty being revealed this morning, Mr. Ewing.
Well, yeah, well, there are certain benefits of being an ex-minister, I guess. But anyway, getting back to the point, did you ever get a response, Mr. Gallant, from the Scottish Government about the idea that, you know, you could pay for what is being suggested this morning, and it's a very strong case, by, if you like, limiting or reducing or shaving off the benefits of people like myself and many, many others who are over 60 and are entitled to this free bus pass, even though we're well able to afford it? Did you ever get any response at all to that?
No, I didn't. However, there is a, because of a slight change in the economic situation, it's actually no longer necessary to raise the age for senior citizens from 60 to 61. The scheme would now be self-financing because bus fares have been going up and train fares have been static. Therefore, the scheme would actually bring in financial benefits.
Yeah.
Because the Scottish, because the more people who transfer from buses to trains, it means the Scottish Government would not have to pay bus operators 76% of the bus fare.
Yeah. Well, I think I when you made that point in response to Mr. Sweeney's question earlier on, that when asked how much would it cost, you said, well, it wouldn't cost anything, it'd be self-financing. But just to play the devil's advocate, I mean, your thesis there about why it wouldn't cost anything does rely on an assumption that people would be switching from bus to train. But would it not be the case that if what you wanted was granted and there's free rail travel for people with disability, many of them may now not use the bus at all, not least because of the practical problems of lack of toilet facilities? In other words, there would be some people who would use, with a disability, who will use a benefit of free rail travel who do not currently travel on the bus at all. So there would be bound to be some extra cost, would there not?
It could be for a very small number of people, but of course it's impossible to predict what the economic situation will be in the future. But I don't see inflation coming down rapidly.
No. Okay. Well, it's not a question that I would frankly expect you necessarily to be able to answer, because the economics and the calculations are all pretty complex here, as we've seen from the information we've got from the Information Centre in Parliament. But thank you very much for putting your case, and I think you've both made the points very well, so thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Can I say I think the committee is very sympathetic to the case that you've made. We'll obviously be able to consider the evidence afresh and decide how next best to take forward the petition. But before we draw anything to a conclusion today, is there anything further you would like to say to us? David?
No, I think just about covered everything.
Thank you. And Nicoletta?
I might just like to just leave some words from somebody that we support who has a very rare eye condition and who is also a single parent. So this person has said, I go everywhere by bus only because of free companion travel. That's the reason I use the bus over the train, because of the concession rate for whoever is with me. I'd rather take the train, as the bus can be so unreliable, especially in the darker nights, which reduces what vision I do have. I take the train more if I could, but with the cost of living, it's too expensive to always pay the fare for my companion, and I can't expect my sister or whoever is with me to pick up the cost. The train has better facilities too, access to a toilet, and it's much easier when I've got my wee girl with me. There's also more space, as I'm not always able to get on the bus with my buggy if a wheelchair user is already on. If we could get free companion travel on trains like what we have on the bus, it would make life so much easier.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Colleagues, we would normally consider the evidence a future meeting, but I think one issue that's come out of this is the issue of the companion travel and the local authority. I wonder if we're content actually to initiate a series of inquiries of the local authorities that offer this scheme, just in relation to the uptake of it, the working practices in terms of the understanding of passengers and rail staff. And I think obviously issues have been identified about which it would be interesting to know if the supporting local authorities are aware of passengers unable to access the ticket at the start of their journey, finding that they're then not entitled to the reduction at the end of the journey. I think it would be interesting to just initiate some inquiries on those points, which would help us, I think, inform our next discussion. Mr. Sweeney?
Yeah, also might be interesting regarding the financing of the scheme. I note that the current concessionary travel scheme for older and disabled persons has a 55% rate against the full adult single fare, and they have an overall budgetary cap of £226 million in the current financial year. It might be interesting to see what the actual utilisation rate of that budget is, and if it could be then actually funded through simply the provision that's already there if it's underutilised.
Yeah. I mean, I think we can agree it would be interesting to have consideration, and we can then have that information available when we next consider the petition. In which case, I'd like to thank both David and Nicoletta very much for coming along this morning. It's very much appreciated. It certainly helped inform our consideration of the petition. And I'll now suspend the committee briefly and to allow a change. Thank you. Welcome back again to our third evidence session this morning. And this is in relation to petition number 1859 to retain falconers' rights to practice upland falconry in Scotland. And it's been brought to the committee by Barry Blyther. And Barry, the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Animals and Wildlife Act 2020 to allow mountain hares to be hunted for the purposes of falconry. And we're joined this morning by the petitioner, Barry Blyther. Good morning. Welcome to our deliberations. We've managed to consider this petition from time to time along the way and has provoked some quite interesting discussion amongst the committee. So we have a number of questions that we'd like to put to you.
Okay.
But before we get to that, I understand you'd like to say a few words to us, and I invite you so to do.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, first of all, I understand that Dr. Fox hasn't been able to get an internet connection to create a remote link to the committee this morning, which is a little bit unfortunate. But you have, the outline of an opening statement that he was going to prepare. I don't have a copy of that in front of me, but I'm sure you will have considered it anyway. So just as an introduction and to make a few extra final points before the Q&A starts, I just prepared a short opening statement. So if it's OK, I'll just read through that.
Please
just
do.
Now. So my name is Barry Blyther. I'm the petitioner for the matter at hand, and I would first like to thank the convener and the committee members for inviting me here today. I would also like to thank everyone from the public and the wider falconry community who have contributed to the petition so far. Falconry has been my passion basically all my life, and in 1996 I decided to make it my full-time profession. I moved to Scotland, made it my home, and I've never looked back. It has become more of a way of life to me over the years, and this is why I'm in front of you today. The legislation that came into force on March the 1st, 2021 as amendment to the Wildlife and Countryside Act is quite simply flawed. From a conservation angle, an animal welfare angle, and from a democratic angle, it's a little bit of a travesty. An add-on that I would like to make, and I'd need you to consider what you've read from Dr. Fox at this point, but just as a minor add-on from his last submission, I would like to repeat, oh, sorry, to add that the Scottish Government have on a number of occasions mentioned how they consulted on the legislation with NatureScot and the Scottish Hawk Board. They did consult with both bodies, but the illusion that we're presented with is to suggest that that consultation was in advance of the passing of the legislation. It wasn't. It was after the legislation was passed, and it was only to discuss the shaping of licensing. The result of the licensing makes a mockery of the Scottish Government's claim that the protection offered to the mountain hare does not impede the falconer's ability to meet their legal and moral obligations to allow their birds the freedom to demonstrate behaviour natural to the species. It absolutely stymies that option. To expand on this, we have to remember that under the guidelines provided by government, based on the government-provided JNCC range map for mountain hares, falconers should now only fly their birds on the 2.5% of Scotland's landmass, mostly built up, where they have no chance of seeing a hare and catching it. This means that the falconer cannot anymore provide even a school talk, a flying demonstration at a game fair or a village gala. He can't do bird deterrent work to prevent bird strikes with aircraft and subsequent aviation disasters, or keep pest species away from food producing plants in any part of that 97.5% landmass of the country. They would face prosecution under the Wildlife and Countryside Act if the birds saw a hare in those locations and took it. We must remember that one of the ways NatureScot says pest controllers should keep gulls away from undesirable or dangerous locations before they may apply for a licence to remove gull nests is by using falconry, the very practice that now places the falconer at risk of prosecution across this huge part of the country. The Scottish Government has unfortunately no understanding of upland falconry. This may be in part why falconry has been snagged as an unintended bycatch of the legislation, but when their own spice briefing is focused on a completely separate falconry discipline, it's not surprising that their judgments are a little flawed. Now, I won't bore the committee with a long repeat of the information you have at hand from the submissions and the information that has already been provided, but the final point I would like to make are these. The legislation was brought in as a quick exploitation through the corruptions of the suggestions put forward about grouse moor management in the Werribee report. This report, we must remember, just like the brief parliamentary debate, does not mention falconry at all. The aim of the legislation was to prevent the mass culling of hares by shooting, which many people have found intolerable and unpalatable. The report suggests that data was missing, and that if in 5 years hare numbers were deemed unfavourable following more accurate counting, the licensing of shooting should be considered. The data on the hare numbers has already been exposed as flawed. Numbers are likely to be 2 and 6 times greater than the numbers used to justify the amendment. Indeed, on managed land, hare numbers are likely to be 35 times greater than those on unmanaged land. The counts made were largely on unmanaged land. The point has been suggested that hare numbers cannot sustain the pressure of falconry. Let's put that in its place. Hares have sustained the pressure of shooting, and at the lowest numbers of hares quoted as killed by shooting each year are at 26,000, and the highest numbers quoted are at 50,000. based on the most optimistic numbers of hares taken by falconers in a given season, for falconry to account for the number of hares taken by shooting in 1 year would take falconry between 26 and 50 years. So just wrapping up, you'll be glad I'm nearly done. The pressure of falconry is so infinitesimally small, as agreed by Nature Scott, that it cannot be considered relevant. This is why when we look at the Wildlife and Countryside Act, we note that for the very same reason, there is an exemption from the legislation that protects birds, which quotes, for the purpose of falconry. Nature Scott has suggested that it does not understand why the same derogation has not been made in the Act relevant to mammals, and indeed it does not support the omission. All that is required to correct this is a small amendment to the legislation to bring mammal and bird legislation in line, an amendment far less complicated than that which has already been imposed. It does not require any change in primary legislation. The change we require to allow the 4,000-year-old art of falconry to continue, bring the welfare, education, conservation and commercial benefits that it brings with it, is simply the line in the legislation, except for the purpose of falconry. That's all I've got, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Blythe. And that is a very comprehensive statement in support of the aims of the petition. It touches on issues which we as a committee have tried to address, and is obviously underpins the reason why we have you with us this morning. And you're correct, we had hoped to be joined by Dr. Nick Fox, who was going to hopefully achieve a parliamentary first by joining us from an international flight. But unfortunately, he's not over the 2.5% of airspace which allows a connection to be achieved with our debate this morning. And we're going to touch, I think, in the evidence as we develop the discussion on the issues that you've raised. But since this is really the first opportunity there's been for the whole discipline of falconry to have an airing here in parliamentary discussion, I thought it might be useful just in the first instance to get an overview of what the practice of falconry entails and what its cultural and social significance to Scotland is.
With respect, I can't in the room, with the amount of time that's available, give you a big overview of the whole practice of falconry as a pastime, as a sport, as a hobby, or anything else. But what I can do is narrow down and hopefully bring some focus for your considerations, this discipline, this point of upland falconry, especially with a large buzzard-type species and eagles. I've heard it mentioned in the committee room on several occasions when we've talked about birds catching grouse, birds catching rabbits, birds catching stoats. And, well, no one's going to want to catch a stoat with any kind of bird of prey. But, yes, you can take a falcon onto a grouse moor and you can hunt for a grouse. You can take the same falcon onto the lowland and with the birds you can hunt a partridge. You can take a hawk onto farmland and even, indeed, in more urban situations and use them for pest control to catch a rabbit, even though rabbits are becoming vanishingly rare these days. The focus here is upland falconry. I can imagine that the committee has a picture of a falconer wearing their glove with a medium-sized bird of prey on the fist, carrying it around in the countryside, looking for a quarry item, releasing the bird, it chases it for a few moments and catches it. That's got nothing to do with upland falconry. It's not connected. And this is where we are caught out. So I will rent an estate, perhaps 10, 20, 30,000 acres, with a group of friends so that we can afford it, because frankly it's bloody expensive, and then either in Land Rovers or perhaps an Argo Cat, we'll make our way out onto the hill, and this is proper Cairngorm mountain upland countryside. We're looking to get onto a ridge maybe 2.5 at a minimum, perhaps 3,500 feet on the ground before we even start. We get to that position, the eagle is prepared, and we're looking for a ridge which has a windward facing side. And at this point, the eagle is released. And this is where the eagle gets to be an eagle, to demonstrate behaviour natural to the species. in that screaming gale, as an aside, the highest wind speed on the ground that I've flown an Eagle so far is 87 miles an hour. The wind speed at altitude probably closer to 140 miles an hour. You release the Eagle, and as the wind hits the hill, it's pushed upwards, and these enormous wings, those very wings that make it unsuitable for an Eagle to fly in woodland, near fences, in towns, and more enclosed spaces, suddenly give the Eagle the opportunity to rise on the soar to 2, 3, 4,000 feet. And it may not come back to ground. It may not touch ground again for 4 hours. It's up there busily being an Eagle. Now, if we're actively hunting, our job on the ground would be to drop off the sides of the hill, move through the countryside, move through the heather moorland, and see if we flush a hare. If it's just about exercising the Eagle, we'll stay on the ridge where they're maybe not game, and we'll move backwards and forwards. And the Eagle, because its training has led it to understand or believe that all of the good things in life happen with, near, or around us, it, at altitude, will track our position from up in the sky. An Eagle in this situation, a trained Eagle in this situation, remember the environment that we're in. It's not going to see a rabbit. They can't live at these huge altitudes and in the weather and the conditions that are there. If there are grouse around, I have to make sure that all of the training that's been put into any of our birds is designed to have the Eagle avoid grouse, because that's going to get us kicked off the moor, and realistically, it's not a legitimate quarry for the Eagle anyway. They're too expensive for us, and it's not what we're there to do. What we're aiming to do in that hunting environment is have the Eagle behave and fly in the same style of and as well or better than its wild counterpart. This is why we get called upon to create footage for natural history documentaries, at one end of the scale, blue chip films for Nat Geo and Netflix, and at the other end of the scale, something more light-hearted like Countryfile, Landward, or Winter Watch. But we're called upon because of that entirely natural behaviour. And if the Eagle sees a hare, it is going to follow its natural instincts and put in that devastating vertical stoop or near vertical stoop back to ground in a bid to catch the hare. On around 15% of occasions, it will be successful. But as evolution has shaped the predator and the prey, in most situations, on most occasions, the hare, quite frankly, makes the Eagle look quite foolish, outmanoeuvres it, and trots off up the hills largely unconcerned. It is worth noting that even though the proposals for using falconry as a pest control method for hares to protect crops and trees and so on, even though it's unworkable, we simply cannot fly an Eagle in forestry. It can't see the ground because it's going to fly at altitude. It can't get between the trees. It is 7 feet wide, and most of the gaps between the trees are just a few feet. The forestry is surrounded by fences, and if an Eagle hits a fence, it's going to be killed. Leaving all of this aside, the aim is to have the bird fly in an entirely natural style. And if it catches a hare, we need to remember that unlike other methods of pest control, it is a non-wounding activity. The Eagle puts in a stoop and it catches the hare. And with the enormous power of an Eagle's feet, the hare is effectively switched off as quickly as it would have been if it was shot. But what never happens is that the hare gets away wounded. We don't leave an injured hare that's been shot in the leg or the foot, etc. It's either caught or it's not.
Okay. And, well, I'm going to bring in Fergus Hugh in a second, but it just for the editorial point of view of our understanding, how many falconry businesses are, how many people do you estimate there are, like yourself, who are involved in this business? I mean, is there a quantifiable employment underpinning the practice of falconry?
I'm not going to pretend to suggest to you that I understand the number of falconry businesses. There are lots of small micro businesses that serve local areas, doing village galas, educational school talks and so on. There are other larger businesses, yeah, which might be a visitor attraction. There's medium-sized businesses like my own. There are six of us working. We run a breeding for conservation program. But the Breeding for Conservation program, because there's no support for it, for example, is entirely self-funded. So it relies on the business doing well to be able to continue the breeding program. And any business like ours, anything really that operates outdoors in Scotland, is always going to have a tough time in winter. So there is limited scope to what a business like ours can do to keep to keep turnover moving, to keep cash flow moving during the course of the winter. And although the contribution it makes is modest, being able to take guests out into the mountain to see an eagle doing its thing, whether it's hunting or not, remember that some guests will come to us and want to see an eagle doing its thing, but they're not really quite sure about whether or not they want to see it hunting. But for an eagle to do its thing, we've got to go into the same place. So we have to be completely honest when we put it to the guest that we'll endeavour not to move a hare. But if an eagle is at altitude, or any of the large birds of prey are at altitude and they see one, instinct is going to kick in. So it may take it regardless. But to return to your point, yes, there are a number of businesses all over the country. I cannot give you a number. Okay. Unfortunately, I just don't have the answer to that.
All right.
Active falconers that are interested in flying in areas where there are hares, as my understanding is at the moment, within Scotland, without tourist falconers coming here, stands at around 120, 121, I believe.
OK, that's helpful. Thank you very much. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning.
Morning.
Barry, and thank you for the petition. And can I start off by saying that your evidence is that you had no opportunity whatsoever to contribute to or be consulted about this law prior to its passage. Is that right?
Absolutely, at no point at all. Yeah.
I do think that that's something that is completely wrong. I won't dwell on that, but I just want to make that point. Could I ask you, though, now the law is the law, it's passed. What is the impact of the 2020 Act on falconry?
Remember that we are in this niche area of falconry when we're talking about specifically the practice of hunting hares in the uplands. That's quite a small and modest part of the falconry community that want to do that and are in a position where they've got the birds that make it suitable. The bigger issue, that how it affects falconry more broadly, is the way I've touched upon it in my opening statement. The government suggested that if a falconer is going to put himself or herself in a position where they're going to eliminate the possibility of them being prosecuted if their bird catches a hare, they must endeavour to make sure that any free flying they do with their birds takes place in an area where they are either definitely not or highly unlikely to see a hare. Mm. Now, as I mentioned earlier, with the JNCC map, Joint Nature Conservation Council map, that was provided by government to give us the range that hares are known to inhabit in Scotland, that basically precludes 97.5% of the country as being a safe zone. Now, to quantify that, to put that in a real-world scenario, I do pest control to keep gulls away from a vast area in a big property in Forfar. But it sits right at the edge of the bottom of the Angus Glens. And if I sit on the roof with a bird of prey that I'm flying backwards and forwards to try to disperse adult gulls early in the season to have them avoid coming in here to build nests, if I sit there with binoculars, I can see hares that are just changing their colour, and even the very first leverets, as we go into May, just hopping around about half a mile or three quarters of a mile away from where I am. Now, if I go to that site to try to deter gulls with a bird of prey, it opens up the legitimacy for me to apply for a licence later in the season, which would make it legal for me to remove gull eggs and nests to protect the site. If preventative measures, and one of the approved preventative measures is falconry, are not followed, and I cannot evidence that I have followed them, then I can no longer get the licence. But the world that I'm in now means that if I release the hawk, it flies up to a large part of the building. Over there, a quarter or half a mile away, it sees a hare, it flies off the roof and catches it. It's a predator. It's just following its instinct. It's an infinitesimally small chance that it will happen, but a very real chance nonetheless. But if it happens, I'm now open for prosecution. So the government is telling me I have to do this before I can get a licence to continue my programme. But if I do it and the bird catches a hare, they're going to prosecute me anyway.
So, I mean, is it over-dramatic or too generalised? Too generalised a statement to state that the effect of this law is to make every falconer a potential criminal if they carry out the practice of falconry.
Absolutely. And whether it be a school talk or a gala or a film job, doesn't matter what you're doing. If you're free flying a bird of prey at all in 97.5% of Scotland, if the bird sees a hare and it catches it, then you are at risk of prosecution. I mean, it makes everything that we do potentially a criminal offence.
It's a matter of record that falconry was not mentioned whatsoever in the 2020 debate. And I think it's also fair to say that when a criminal offence has been created by Parliament, it's essential that proper consideration is given to any conceivable circumstances of prosecution. That simply did not happen here. It's quite shocking. I think you're actually owed an apology by the Scottish Government for that. But moving on to solutions, one solution is that a change in the law is made, and you've said that that would not require primary legislation. Could you maybe just explain exactly what you mean as to how in practice your solution could be implemented? Because I had thought that primary legislation would be required, namely an amendment to the 2020 Act. But, I mean, are you saying that subordinate legislation could be used as a means of solving this, or do you envisage that some other solution is possible, such as a general licence, which I think is something that Dr. Fox said was a possible solution, convener, in his evidence?
Licensing is viable. I see it being onerous for falconers. Bearing in mind, just looking at pest control, we already have to fly birds of prey to enable us to get a licence to enable us to remove gull nests. So from the pest control falconer's point of view, we would now have to justify the application for and apply for a licence. Nature Scott would have to issue the licence. We would then have to practice that part of our pest control programme for the summer and then apply for another licence to remove the gull nests. So we're bombarding, or everybody would be bombarding Nature Scott with this cycle of licences. And that's just from the pest control angle. Then we've got the number I quoted just now, active falconers looking to hunt hares, another 121 people making an application for a licence. Then you've got both national and international tourists coming from other parts of the UK and Europe, all wanting to come and hunt the hare potentially in Scotland. Or if they, even if they don't want to hunt a hare, because of the risk under the legislation that exists now that they could be prosecuted if they catch one as a byproduct, they've got to apply for a licence anyway. So now we've got Belgian and Dutch and Czech Republic and French falconers all applying for a licence, not because they want to catch a hare, but they want to come and see if they can hunt a rabbit, but they might catch one and they don't want to be prosecuted. So we've got all of these issues around licensing that I could see would just make it complicated for the people on the ground that are applying and indeed the people that are issuing the licences. It's my belief that an amendment, and forgive me if I'm wrong, I'm not a parliamentary or, I'm not the right kind of person to make the exact comment, but I have been led to believe that in the same way that an amendment was placed on the current mammals bill, an amendment just placing the omission for the purposes of falconry is in fact not a change in primary legislation. If that's not correct, I apologise. And
well, we will consider that. I think it's fair to say that's within our view. But just to pursue the point about the impacts, I mean, is there any way in which falconers could maintain their work without impacting the protected species? In other words, is there not some way in which you can carry on with falconry despite the problems of facing a potential prosecution?
Well, I could potentially fly my eagle in the car park at Hart Hill Services. I could potentially fly around the docks in Aberdeen Harbour, perhaps on some of the rigs that are being repaired just off the coast there in Aberdeen. The reality of it is no. If we want to absolutely eliminate the chances of specifically upland falconers being prosecuted, there isn't a current way to do it. I mentioned before, this is just about being honest, the risk of doing an educational talk at a school in the Cairngorm or Grampian region leading to a hawk flying over the fence and catching a hare is limited, but it's real. It has happened to me. I've been in a situation where I've been providing a flying demonstration at a venue and the hawk has left the arena and caught a hare nearby. Now, remember that birds of prey are naturally wide-ranging and free-flying. So another picture is, and here's a very viable one, flying demonstration in the Highland Games Field at Braemar. just at the edge of Invermarkie Stake. Birds flying around doing its thing. All of a sudden, fire engine comes into the arena as part of a separate display. Eagle doesn't like the look of that. Drifts off 2-3 miles out onto the hill. Well, now you've got an eagle flying around out on the edge of the hill. It's a predator. Hares live there. It could catch one. So I'm not there to catch a hare, but the risk of it doing so are very real, and they do exist.
So any falconry at all could lead to any falconer facing prosecution.
Absolutely.
Right. Could I just ask one final question, if I may, Convener, which is, and you touched on this in your evidence, I just want to make sure that I understood it properly, namely the kind of the number of mountain hares that are kind of taken by the birds that are used in falconry. And I think it was your evidence that really, compared with shooting, we're talking about a very small number. But can you maybe just, and I think you did mention some figures, but could you maybe just clarify what your view is about the impact overall of falconry on the number of mountain hares that are killed in relation to the overall statistics regarding hares? And I know there's a lot of controversy about the numbers, because those in the kind of country sports side think that the hares are not under threat at all, and that there is a lack of evidence, and they want to sort that. But what is your view about the impact of falconry on the number of hares killed in Scotland?
As I mentioned in the opening statement there, depending on what figures you believe, and as you mentioned, there is a huge disparity, but the lowest number of hares that I've seen quoted as accounted by shooting annually in Scotland is 26,000. The general range is between 26,000 and 38,000, and the highest number I've seen quoted are 50,000. Now, for the record, I must say that I have no issue with shooting. I go on to managed moorlands, and despite what you read in the press and the stories that come out, the stories about these big barren wastelands and monocultures are largely not true. And on these managed estates, the hare populations are absolutely burgeoning. Mm. There are tens of thousands of them. You can literally be at the point where whole hillsides seem to be moving with hares. And for this reason, I don't have an issue with shooting at all. It's not my bag at all, but I don't have any kind of problem with shooting whatsoever. But we're not here to talk about shooting. We're here to talk about the impact on falconry. So a comparison is always going to come into place. Now, if we refer again to that 121 falconers that are interested in practising falconry in the UK, if we take the statistics that were put together kindly for us by A Future with Falconry, it would suggest that if every single one of those falconers went onto the hill for the maximum amount of available time they've got each year, and bearing in mind that this is a winter activity, most of this is happening sort of October at a push, November, December, January and into February, the core of the historic season for hares. But if every single one of them went there for the maximum possible amount of time that they could, were never affected by weather, the hawk was successful enough that they reached the maximum number of hares that they would ever want to take in a day, and every single one of them did it in a year, the maximum number of hares that would be accounted for in Scotland is just over 2,800. But in reality, if you bring that down to a real-world scenario, you lose, when you're flying in these upland places, you lose days out because of heavy snow. You just can't see. Indeed, rain or flood. Sometimes you can't get across the fog to get on the hill. Fog and low cloud are the biggest issue. We probably lose around about 50 or 60% of the days that we're on the hill to weather or conditions on the ground. So you then bring it down to the reality being that falconers in Scotland are probably accounting for an absolute real-world maximum of 1,000 hares.
And that's really, in terms of the overall hare population, despite this, the controversy over the counting methods, around 1,000 is de minimis, it's negligible. It's
infinitesimally small. Nature Scotland have already said that they consider it so infinitesimally small that it can't even be quantified. But just on that point, the one thing that I would like to say is that what the legislation has done is it has devalued the hare. It's gone from a game species to being a pest species. Now, a game species has a commercial value to the estates. An estate is there to make money. Whether you're a supporter of field sports or shooting or any of the other field sports at all, it doesn't change the fact that these estates carry a vast areas of Scotland. They are well managed for the animals that are desirable to be there, and the desired animals there are those that bring revenue to the estate. When you move a hare from being a game species to a pest species, you take it from an animal that is a nuisance, it eats the same food as game species that bring you money. It competes with grouse. It carries a tick, which is carries a sheep-borne disease called louping ill. Although the hare can't carry louping ill, it can transfer the tick from sheep or deer to the grouse. That kills the grouse. Now, historically, that risk of damage to the wider activity of the estate would have been mitigated by the fact that people would go to the estate and pay money to shoot hares, or indeed falconers such as myself would pay money to fly my eagles over them. Now that we can't, and the only way that you can take a hare is where it's considered a pest, damaging crops, forestry, etc., it now has no value to the estate. So the estate is going to become less tolerant of them. They're not going to manage the estate in a way that is going to support hares. They're going to do everything they can within the realms of what's possible within the law to try to move them on. If there are peat hags, hares love to sit in a peat hag. Got the peat behind them, they've got protection behind, so a predator can't see them coming. They can look out over the open moor, they can get water, they can step over there and take a bite of heather, come back in, and they're protected. They love peat hags. Not really anything else on the hill likes a peat hag. And when you're walking on the hills, they're awful because you fall over in them and end up to your neck in peat and boggy water. What would the estate do now that it can't shoot the hare? Get rid of the peat hags. What happens then? The hares move off. The habitat that keeps them protected from the natural predators that live there is being depleted, so hare numbers go down. This is an absolute own goal for the conservation of hares. It will see their numbers collapse. If their numbers are allowed to explode without control, then the issue for them is disease. If their numbers don't explode, then their numbers will deplete because the estate have no motivation, they've got no appetite to protect the species because they no longer bring revenue.
To bring in David Torrance, who would like to ask a question.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. Since the legislation came into place and birds have been restricted from doing what they naturally do, the captive birds that you've got, welfare of them, how has that affected them not being able to go and hunt mountain hares?
The easy way to answer that is probably to talk about just two birds, just as an example to keep it simple. Our collection, including the conservation programme, is around 70. Some are unaffected because they're here for breeding for conservation from various locations around the world. But if we just take two birds as an example, I've got two golden eagles, an unnamed female that was bred in captivity in Scotland in the year 2000, and a male that you're going to meet this afternoon called Stanley, who was bred, I believe, in the Czech Republic, although I may get that wrong, and he's about 15 years old. Throughout their lives, the birds have been trained to fly in exactly the discipline that I described earlier on, out onto the open hill, screaming gale, wide open spaces, not a fence to be seen in 30 miles. That's what they do. If we take those eagles and fly them in a different discipline within falconry, so we take them out to a flat field, maybe there's broccoli growing or something similar, and there are brown hares. You hold the eagle up in the air, somebody flushes a brown hare, it's taking the eagle outside of its skill set, and it looks at the hare, looks at me, and basically says, what exactly the hell do you expect me to do with that? There is no understanding. It just lifts its foot, has a little rouse, preens its feathers, and goes back to doing nothing. Those two eagles, since the legislation was brought into force, have both been sitting in an aviary and have not flown more than 20 feet in 2.5 years. These are two eagles whose entire lives have followed a cycle of picked up for retraining, exercise and management of their condition to get their cardiovascular system up to top form, to get them flying and active. We then take them out into the hill and we fly them in those environments for a minimum of 6 out to 9 weeks as blocked, booked days out on the hill and extended days elsewhere where we can snatch a day here and there. It's all they know how to do, and quite simply, they do not understand how to do anything else. The 15-year-old male eagle will probably live to be about 40, and under the current legislation, it will not fly again. The 23-year-old female eagle she will probably live to be closer to 50, and under the current legislation, she will probably never fly again.
Thank you. Well, I think the discussion we've been able to have this morning has been fascinating and compelling. And as you say, you have brought Golden Eagle with you today, and we are looking forward to meeting Stanley. As you said in your evidence, if Stanley were flying above Hart Hill Station, he apparently would have to understand the precincts of Hart Hill Station.
Absolutely.
Better than most motorists who probably go through Hart Hill Station do. But if he were to stray beyond the precincts of Hart Hill Station, he would survive with impunity, but you would be prosecuted for
exactly right.
Anything he might then do. I don't know if we were going to be able... I said that he wasn't here to give evidence. He was here in evidence. But, I think the absurd thing is, you know, we're almost at the situation where the legislation requires us to ask Stanley if he understands the perimeters within which he's entitled to hunt, which I think illustrates the nonsensical nature of it all. Mr. Blyther-Barry, thank you very much. I think that's been incredibly helpful. I think that this petition has identified, and I think the committee is aware of this, a real issue that we will want to find a way to pursue, and we look forward to meeting you and Stanley again in a short while, and I'll suspend the committee just now. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
We're still in public for this.
And welcome back. We're now still on continuing petitions, and we are now looking at petition number 1905, the public inquiry into the response of religious organisations to allegations of child sexual abuse since 1950, lodged by Angela Rosina Cousins on behalf of UK XJW support, calling on the Scottish Government, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to order a public inquiry into the actions taken by religious organisations in response to child sexual abuse since 1950. The committee will recall the evidence we heard directly from the petitioner, Angela, about her experiences and the issues she would like to see addressed. And can I once again thank Angela for taking the time to speak with the committee on what was a particularly difficult topic. And at our last consideration of the petition, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government to highlight the evidence session and the findings of the independent inquiry in England and Wales. The independent inquiry in England and Wales has now published its final report and sets out 20 detailed recommendations, some of which relate directly to the suggestions that were made by Angela, and our papers highlight the relevant recommendations. Now, the Deputy First Minister has responded to the committee and reiterated that if the remit of the inquiry was widened, it would add years onto the timeline and produce negative outcomes for survivors. The Deputy First Minister does not consider that the scope of the inquiry should be extended or that a separate inquiry should be established to consider abuse that took place in non-religious residential religious organisations. The Scottish Government set out a number of alternative measures, including engagement with faith leaders and a public consultation as part of work to develop the National Child Protection Guidance in Scotland 2021. That guidance covers reporting practice, creation of policies and procedures, and careful vetting processes within religious settings. Now, Angela has provided a written submission to the committee, which includes links to relevant articles in support of her petition. She points to the research undertaken by the inquiry in England and Wales to reach a decision on mandatory reporting, highlighting the importance of this for victims and insular organisations. Angela says that religious organisations who do not wish to engage will not be required to do so. Angela states that religious leaders should be mandatory reporters and that training should be provided alongside PVG checks as part of any process, any vetting process. So we've heard evidence. We have seen the recommendations from the inquiry in England and Wales. We have yet again received the Deputy First Minister's assertion that they're not willing as a government to increase the scope of the current inquiry or even to initiate a separate inquiry. And we have Angela's response further to all of that. And I just wonder what comments or suggestions colleagues have, given really the intransigent, it seems to me, position with which we're confronted. David?
Convener, it's a very difficult situation that the government's not going to move on this at all, but I wonder if we could write to the Scottish Government and highlight the recommendations of an independent inquiry into child sexual abuse in England and Wales and ask the Scottish Government to consult on the introduction of legislation which places a certain individual's mandate reporters under statutory duty to report child sex abuse and consider the need for and the value of a child protection authority for Scotland.
I'm very happy to support that. Colleagues, happy to support that. I don't particularly still want to lose sight of the conviction that I think we as a committee came to really on the back of the evidence we had heard that the government's position is incorrect, is wrong-headed. And I wonder whether colleagues would be prepared to invite the clerks to draft a letter really summarising our conclusion on the back of the evidence that we've heard, that the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, notwithstanding everything the government has said, should have its terms of reference extended, or that there should be an investigation into the possibility of establishing an alternative inquiry based on the evidence that we have heard in the course of our consideration of this petition. Are colleagues content for us to proceed on that basis as well? So we will keep the petition open and we will proceed on the basis of the two suggestions that have been made. We move now to agenda item 3, which is the consideration of new petitions. The first of these is Petition 1957, Home Reports Make Surveyors More Accountable. And that's been lodged by Catherine Donaghy. And it calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure surveyors are legally responsible for the accuracy of information provided in the single survey and to increase the liability in surveyors to pay repair bills where a home report fails to highlight existing faults in the condition of the property. Catherine has shared her experience of buying a house, only to discover that the property had major faults, which had not been highlighted in the home report. And she tells us these faults included a hole in the roof, missing rainwater and gutter systems, none of which have been noted as having a Category 3 rating requiring urgent or immediate repair. As we do with all new petitions, and I should have said this just a moment ago, ahead of considering them, we do invite the Scottish Government to comment on the underlying principles of the petition and to invite them to respond. And in respect of this petition, the Scottish Government has stated that they consider the tasks of the petition to be inappropriate. A, because the scope of the Home Report survey is outlined at the beginning of the report and clearly identifies the limitations of the survey. And B, because members of the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors carrying out the single survey and valuation in a home report must be appropriately qualified, carry professional indemnity insurance, and have in place a complaints handling procedure which offers independent third party, that's to say people like Catherine, recourse to complaints. In responding to the Scottish Government's view, Catherine Donaghy explains the difficulties she has experienced in pursuing a complaint with the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors and suggests that all home reports should include contact details for the Centre for Effective Dispute Resolution. So an interesting petition. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. This situation, I hope, is just a one-off, but it may not be for this individual who found herself in this situation. You would assume that when you get a report, that the fundamentals within that report would be covered. But I think it's important that we continue to make some reference within this petition. So I would request that we write to the Institute of Chartered Surveyors to seek a view on the issues raised by the petition, requesting information on training and guidance provided to surveyors and valuers to ensure the accuracy of information provided at a home report, and to provide a view on the proposal to include contact details for the Centre of Effective Dispute Resolutions as a matter when they're dealing with a survey. And I also think it would be useful to write to the Law Society of Scotland to seek its views on issues raised once again within this petition. Because, as I said, if this is not a situation that occurs, then it should, that these regulations are there to protect the individual who is purchasing a property, and the surveyors and the quality of that is vitally important.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I mean, I should say that of sceptics of the proposal for home reports, of which I was one, I have to say, at the time, the concern was that the principle underpinning home reports is it would do away with the need for the undertaking of expensive surveys when people were making offers for properties. But if the home report is going to be deficient, it's certainly been my experience in the years since when buying a home that a survey has been required or has still been required as part of the requirements of the mortgage lender. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, in addition to the contents of the letters to the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors and the Law Society, I wonder if we could add further inquiries as to the number of the complaints process, the number of complaints per annum, perhaps the number of the complaints that have been upheld, the number that have been rejected, and in comparison with the total number of home reports.
Yep.
Because, you know, my experience when I was solicitor, albeit in a different century to the one we're now in, was that most surveyors were pretty professional and thorough. And I'm very surprised that a hole in the roof wasn't spotted. It does sound like a pretty patent defect as opposed to a latent defect. But I would be very interested to know how widespread complaints are and the people who make complaints, how they... What the upshot has been, because the petitioner says that her experience was pretty dismal, and it would be good to get the bigger picture. So I wonder if these matters could be added to the letters.
I think that would be very sensible. I mean, I think the experience of the committee in respect of petitions we've considered before has been that sometimes the veneer of a possible recourse on examination by the committee to evidence the substance of it has fallen short of what might have been hoped for or experienced. So I think interrogating the actual practice, experience, numbers and resolution of the existing complaints process would be a sensible thing for us to try and try and establish.
I think in particular to tease out whether or not those complaints that have been upheld have resulted in a remedy, namely a financial recompense, and whether, if that has been the case, that recompense has been provided by the indemnity insurers or by the surveyors. It's probably quite a complicated area, Convener, because I think there'd be an overlap between whether the solicitor was negligent or the surveyor was negligent, and it could be that in some cases both may be, in which case there would be a recourse to dual indemnities, the legal solicitor's professional indemnity insurance and the surveyor's insurance. But nonetheless, it would be useful just to get a picture rather than just look at this in isolation.
Content. Our colleagues content that we proceed on the basis of the suggestions made by most of Mr. Stewart and Mr. Ewing. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I share the concerns raised by the petitioner about the fit-for-purpose nature of home reports. It's a particular consideration. I suppose I should declare interest as a trustee of the Glasgow City Heritage Trust, but tenemental properties in particular, there are major deficiencies in assessing overall building condition in relation to home reports in Glasgow. And I know certainly our colleague Graeme Simpson, MSP, has reconvened the Tenement Maintenance Working Group in the Scottish Parliament. So it might be opportune to also write to All Under One Roof Scotland, the charity that provides impartial advice to homeowners and people purchasing homes, as well as the Built Environment Forum Scotland, who are the secretariat for the Tenement Maintenance Working Group. I certainly know that an action on this is to improve the standard and quality of home reports. I also understand that the Scottish Law Commission are undertaking a project on improving tenement law, and it might be an element of their work that is about improving the regulations around home reports, because I do know there are major issues with people purchasing property based on highly defective information, which then leaves them highly liable for significant repairs to, say, a roof of a tenement which hasn't been assessed as part of a home report. If they have a ground floor flat, for example, they're still liable for the roof. But they haven't actually been looked at all. So I think it's particularly problematic in relation to tenemental property.
Okay. Yeah, we can do that. Are we content to incorporate that as well, John? We are. Thank you. We move next to petition number 1958 to extend aftercare for previously looked after young people and remove the continuing care age gap. This petition has been lodged by Yasmin Kasaya Pilling on behalf of Who Cares Scotland, and the petitioner is with us in the gallery this morning, although isn't contributing to our consideration orally at this time. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to extend aftercare provision in Scotland to previously looked after young people who left care before their 16th birthday on the basis of individual need, to extend continuing care throughout care experienced people's lives on the basis of individual need, and to ensure care experienced people are able to enjoy lifelong rights and achieve equality with non-care experienced people. This includes ensuring that the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and the findings of the promise are fully implemented in Scotland. Now, Jasmin Kasaya tells us some care experienced people in Scotland find it difficult to access services due to the application of arbitrary criteria relating to their age and when they left care. She says care experienced people who leave care before their 16th birthday are not included in the legal definition of care leaver and are therefore not eligible for continuing care and aftercare. This means they are left to navigate difficult issues without the support that many of their care experienced peers are entitled to. She asks the committee to consider how continuing care, the promise and or human rights legislation can strengthen protection in line with the inclusive definition set out by the promise and the First Minister's personal commitment to care experienced people. She suggests that this situation could be fixed by improving existing legislation to ensure all care experienced people have access to support. Responding to the petition, the Scottish Government have said that they are fully committed to improving the lives of our care experienced young people and highlight that continuing care and aftercare are available to young people who are care leavers. The Scottish Government's response mentions a range of support available to young people with care experience and plans to introduce a care experience grant to provide young people with additional financial support. The Government also highlight the publication of the Promise Implementation Plan, setting out the work they are undertaking to keep the promise, made to Scotland's children and young people who are care experienced. Now, I would draw members' attention to the further written submission we've received from Yasmin Kasai, in which she highlights that the Scottish Government have not addressed her concerns about young people who leave care before their 16th birthday, nor the ask to extend support throughout a care experienced person's life. She tells us she is aware of many care experienced peers who have been left to struggle without support due to not being formally looked after at the age of 16, as well as others who have had to push to be kept on compulsory supervision orders when the local authority try to remove them before their 16th birthday. So a very complicated but very serious issue that obviously has an impact. And colleagues, you've had an opportunity to consider the papers and the latest submissions we've received. Have we any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. With the committee's agreement, I would like to invite the petitioner and representatives of Who Cares Scotland, Centre for Excellence of Children's Care and Protection, Scottish Through Care and Aftercare Forum, the Promise and the Children and Young People's Commissioner to a roundtable discussion to explore issues raised in the petition. And if the committee has agreed, could we invite some people with experience, life experiences of the situations that have been raised in the petition?
You're supporting that suggestion. And in advance of that, we might write to various organisations, I think, just to seek their views to help us inform the discussion that takes place. So to the Centre for Excellence of Children's Care and Protection, Scottish Thoroughfare Through Care and Aftercare Forum to get their contributions as well. Do we want to wait until we've had that conversation before we write to the Scottish Government? Mr Ewing?
Should have the round table first and then write to the Scottish Government in order to get a flavour. I'm just going to maybe add just a small suggestion to what Mr Torrance suggested, with which I agree, which is that in seeking to invite individuals with lived experience to participate in the discussion, perhaps we could specifically ask the petitioners who have said that they're aware of other examples, if they would be happy to suggest to us people with that lived experience, because they have knowledge about that, and it would be good to see if they can point us in the right direction.
Yep, I'm happy to agree to that. So we all agreed on that. So I'm able to thank the petitioner personally for bringing the petition to the committee. We take the petition very seriously. And as you can see, we will now write to various organisations ahead of sponsoring a roundtable discussion here in the Parliament, where we can explore the issues in some detail. And in consequence of that, then write to the Scottish Government summarising our thinking and any conclusions that we reach at that time. We all agree. Thank you. We move then to petition number 1959, Tackle Scotland's Affordable Housing Crisis. We finally reached a petition in the year I was born, so it's been creeping up on me. It must have passed years a long time ago, Fergus.
details.
Petition number 1959 to tackle Scotland's affordable housing crisis has been lodged by Amber Roberts, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to take action to improve the current housing crisis by merging housing associations and local council housing and considering introducing a new right to buy scheme for council tenants. Amber suggests that merging housing associations with local council housing could help more council houses become available and result in more than 76,000 council homes being built by 2034. Amber also sets out a proposal for a right to buy scheme, which would allow council tenants who have lived in the property for 10 or more years the opportunity to buy their home. Responding to the petition, the Scottish Government state their approach to the planning and delivery of affordable housing is focused on providing the right homes in the right place, unquote, and they highlight that housing associations and councils have a long history of working in partnership with one another in the delivery of affordable homes, noting that not all councils build new homes, as six local authorities have previously transferred all of their housing stock to housing associations. Reference is made by the Scottish Government's own target of delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which at least 70% will be available for social rent. And this, they highlight, would exceed the number of homes for social rent suggested in the petition and be delivered within a shorter time frame. a lot of houses to be built in 10 years. The Scottish Government have also stated they have no plans to reintroduce the right to buy scheme and have provided details on the support available to assist affordable home ownership. This support includes the low-cost initiative for first-time buyers and the open market shared equity scheme. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. And considering the Scottish Government's response and the plans not to reintroduce the right to buy scheme for council tenants, I think there's nothing that the committee could do but close the petition down under 15.7 of standing orders.
It is difficult to know what meaningful steps we can take forward, given the government's position, and nor, I think, can we wait and keep the petition open until 2032 to see if the 110,000 homes are materialised. But, I mean, obviously that itself is a very challenging issue, but I think given the Scottish Government's very definitive response, I'm unclear as to what more we could do. So our colleagues content that we close this petition on that basis. So we thank Amber Roberts and regret I don't think there is anything more we can actually do of a practical nature. Petition number 1960 to formally recognise private hire cars and taxis as modes of public transport. Lodged by Edward Grice on behalf of the Scottish Private Hire Association, calling on the Scottish Government to formally recognise private hire cars and taxis as modes of public transport and to shine such recognition in law, I should say, to urge the Scottish Government to that end. The SPHA tell us that private hire cars and taxis provide a valuable service and play an important role in local transport. Despite the important role, they go on to tell us they are more often overlooked by planners and policymakers in comparison with other modes of transport, which has led them to being excluded from public transport stakeholder groups and prevented meaningful engagement from taking place in decisions affecting the services they provide. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government highlight there is no legal definition of public transport and each transport mode is subject to specific legislation. And in their view, this means there is no obvious legislation that could be amended to enshrine the definition in law and set out the relationship between the different transport sectors and local and national government. However, the government state they do consider the provision of taxis to be a vital part of the transport system and will continue to engage with industry representatives on matters such as low emissions zones and licensing. I mean, I think we obviously heard from taxi owners in a previous evidence session. This flitted in and out of the conversation. Do members have any suggestions as to how we might proceed? Alexander Stewart.
I think that we need to take some more evidence and information on this, Convener. So I would suggest that you write to the Chief Officers of Transportation Scotland and the Confederation of Passengers Transport and Heads of Planning Scotland to seek their views on the petition, including how the views of a taxi or private hire trade include in their decision-making process, what scope there is to include a taxi and private hire trade in public transport stakeholders groups, and to engage in consultation on decisions that affect the services that they provide, and to write to the Scottish Government to seek an update on what's happening with the short life working group and further information on any action being undertaken to improve the engagement between taxi and private hire industry and planning and licensing authorities. I think that would at least give us an indication of where we are and where we stand with the whole process.
I'm happy to support that. Are colleagues willing to support those suggestions? Mr. Ewing.
Just a small addendum to the inquiry that Mr. Stewart recommended, which I entirely support, is the Scottish Government Short Life Working Group contains members of Transport Scotland, local authorities, Unite the Union, and then it says representatives of the taxi and private hire trade. I wonder if we could ask the government to specify who these representatives are, whether they're sufficient. Is it rather top-heavy with public sector bodies and perhaps not sufficiently representing the range of interests in the taxi and private hire sector? In other words, could we ask the Scottish Government whether they feel that the membership of the Short Life Working Group might be extended to include a greater representation from the people whose lives are...
Yep.
Businesses are affected.
That seems a sensible proposition. Are we content with that? We are. Petition number 1961 to make it a specific offence to assault, threaten or abuse a private hire or taxi driver while at work. This has been lodged by Edward Grice on behalf of the Scottish Private Hire Association. SPHA, and calls the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to expand the protection of workers, retail and age-restricted goods and services, Scotland Act 2021, to include private hire and taxi drivers, by creating a specific criminal offence of assaulting, threatening or abusing private hire or taxi drivers while they're engaged in private hire or taxi work, and considering such offences as aggravated when the offence is committed whilst the driver is enforcing a licensing or operational condition. The SPHA highlight the 2021 Act and the creation of a new offence for situations where a retail worker is assaulted, threatened or abused while engaged in their work. The SPHA believe that a similar offence is required to protect private hire and taxi drivers while at work. Now, in their response to the petition, the Scottish Government note there are a range of common law and statutory offences to protect everyone, including private hire and taxi drivers, from abuse and violence, and these include the statutory offence of threatened or abusive behaviour and common law offences of assault and breach of the peace. Do my colleagues have any comments or suggestions? I was kind of struck by the Scottish Government pointing the finger at Daniel Johnson in relation to this. And I'm not quite sure what they thought Mr Johnson's remedy might be, but colleagues, get any suggestions as to how we might proceed? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee could consider writing to Police Scotland seeking information on the number of threatening and abusive behaviour offences recorded in each year over the past decade, and whether the data can be broken down by occupant and workplace. And I wonder if the committee could also write to Scottish Taxi Federation and Unite Scotland to seek their views on the petition.
I'm content with both those. Are colleagues wish to add anything to that, or are we agreed? We're agreed. Petition number 1963 to phase in a meat production ban by 2040, lodged by Roger Green, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to phase in a ban on meat production in Scotland between 2030 and 40 to coincide with anticipated changes to future food production and consumption. Roger highlights an initiative being implemented by the United Nations, the World Health Organization, to reach a global plant-based diet. Roger states that Scotland should achieve healthy dietary goals by 2030-40, and amongst other dietary priorities, this should include phasing out meat consumption. The Spice briefing provides detailed information on various aspects of meat production, including the economic impacts, proportion of meat eaters in the UK, and the environmental impacts. The briefing states that 70% of people in the UK are meat eaters, and the total agricultural workforce in Scotland is around 67,400 people. It also points to the UK Climate Change Committee's recommendation to bring forward policies to encourage consumers to shift their diets and reduce beef, lamb and dairy production by 20%. The Scottish Government's response states its vision is for Scotland to become a global leader in sustainable and regenerative farming, and highlights funds to encourage adaptation to climate change within the sector. It confirms that the Scottish Government will continue to work closely with Public Health Scotland, Food Standards Scotland and other agencies on diet, health and climate impacts to inform future policy. Do members have any comments or suggestions? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Considering that UK Climate Change Committee recommends a reduction of meat consumption rather than a ban on the production, the Scottish Government's Climate Change Plan update sets out a plan for 24% reduction in overall emissions from agricultural category by 2032, and that banning meat production may have a negative environmental and economic consequences, and that the Scottish Government has stated that it continues to actively promote the consumption of fresh, local and seasonal produce. I would like the committee to consider closing the petition under 15.7 of standing orders.
I think, given the response of the Scottish Government and its detailed explanation of the various initiatives it has before it, there's little more we as a committee could do. Are colleagues content on that basis to close the petition? We are. We then move to petition 1964 to create an independent review of the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. Apologies, I've quite a long screed to read you here, but this is our final petition this morning. And it's lodged by Accountability Scotland, and it calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create an independent review of the SPSO in order to A, investigate complaints made against the SPSO, B, assess the quality of its work and decisions, and finally to establish whether the current legislation governing the SPSO is fit for purpose. Now, the SPICE briefing outlines the role and responsibilities of the SPSO and the budget and resource challenges, the complaints process, service standards and challenges. It states that over a four-year period, the SPSO received 369 complaints about the service it provides. And the briefing also highlights the SPSO's request for a change to legislation to allow it to take complaints in any format and to enable it to initiate its own investigations. A note of previous related petitions is also contained in our briefing. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that due to current resource constraints, the independent nature of the Ombudsman and Parliament's role in scrutinising the work of the Ombudsman, it does not intend to take forward an independent review of the SPSO in the near future. The Scottish Government also states that it has opted not to amend the legislation in relation to the powers of the SPSO at present due to competing demands and resources. Now, members may wish to note the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee took evidence from the Ombudsman yesterday as part of its scrutiny of the SPSO's annual report, and I understand that that consideration did not include the issues raised by the petitioner. Now, we've received several additional submissions from the petitioner and others, and these set out concerns about the complaints process and the SPSO's consideration and handling of evidence, including the approach taken where factual errors have been identified. People's negative experiences and the impact of the SPSO complaints handling process and complaints has also been highlighted. And issues raised include the challenges of self-investigation and the need for structural independence. And the submissions call for an independent review of the SPSO. Accountability Scotland say they would welcome clarification from the Scottish Government as to whether it considers there is value in an independent review. I also thought that in an interesting submission to the committee from Bob Dorris, MSP, he states that he believes there is a clear value in reviewing the SPSO 20 years on, as there has been no meaningful or detailed analysis of the processes and system currently in place. And he suggests there would be merit in exploring how effective the SPSO is, including the effectiveness of the safeguards and what changes are required. He also suggests that we may wish to understand the Scottish Government's thinking on whether or not such a review would be desirable. I mean, it did strike me reading the Scottish Government's response that they weren't necessarily denying some of the issues that were raised in the petition, but simply took the view that they didn't feel they had the resource or the time at the moment to actually explore these going forward. But nor did they express, as Bob Dorris says, a view as to whether they thought doing so in itself would be something of value and to be considered at a later date. Do we have any suggestions as to how we might proceed? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I'm just wondering, before we make any other recommendations, if we could write to Local Government Housing and Planning Committee to ask what relevant work they're going to do in this area, and if they're going to look into what the petition's asking for.
Apparently we have already established that and they are not interested in pursuing the issues the petitioner has raised.
If that is the case, I wonder if the committee would like to ask a petitioner to come and give evidence in front of us and the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. And I've got a rather lengthy ask then now that we also write to the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman on the issues raised in the petition, including its approach to handling and the consideration of evidence and the rationale not to review its decisions when complaints are upheld. And I wonder if we could write to the Scottish Government as well to clarify a view on the need for the desirability of a review of the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman after 20 years of operation and ask if it considers that the process and safeguards in relation to SPOSO are sufficient and effective, and ask if it considers that the legislation governing SPSO is fit for purpose and would benefit from a review, and what revisions may be required.
I'm very happy to write to the various organisations as suggested, but I think we would do that instead of taking evidence from the petitioner at this stage. So we would write, as you've suggested, the SPSO and to the Scottish Government. Any other suggestions? Are members content that we proceed on that basis, Mr Stewart?
I think it would also be quite useful to write to the Scottish Parliament corporate body seeking clarification of its role in relation to the SPSO and views on the action carried out for the petition, specifically with the value of the independent review of the SPSO, convener as well.
Well, that's very generous of you, Mr Stewart, since I'm on the corporate body, but therefore we're one of the people who will be in receipt of the letter you've suggested. Mr Sweeney.
Yeah, I would support those proposals. I noted that a similar petition was brought before the committee in 2014, and it was recommended at that point that there should be oversight, but that the government had advised that it was too soon to consider this in light of the legislation in 2002. Feels like we're sufficiently distant from that juncture to now reconsider the issue, and whether there might be a means where the Scottish Parliament as an institution holds greater oversight of the Ombudsman, perhaps through a discrete committee that actually can be the ultimate arbiter or the ultimate escalating body, perhaps.
Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I do agree with Mr. Sweeney that it must be time for some sort of review after 20 years, and the can has been kicked down the road so much that there can't be much road left. I also note the budget has increased from 4.7 to 6.3 million in just 4 years, and yet the SPSO say that they have insufficient resources because of case volumes. I'd be interested to learn a bit more information about that, because on the face of it, the increases have been much more handsome than other public bodies have necessarily received over that period. And finally, I mean, to be fair to the Ombudsman, one of the limitations is that it hasn't really got any teeth. And therefore, even complainants who do get, if you like, an upheld complaint, don't have any actual remedy. They don't get any cash, they don't get anything else. They might get an apology if they're lucky. But that is an inherent limitation. That's not the fault of the Ombudsman convener, but it is something I would have thought that would fall to be considered in any review as to whether or not the role of an Ombudsman is actually efficacious and whether it achieves what society might expect where there has been serious maladministration.
Yeah, I think I'm happy to take all those suggestions on board. I mean, this Parliament has existed for not much longer than that, and we've managed to have two or three reviews into how we operate and function. It seems perfectly reasonable that after a similar length of time, it might be time to have a look at the way the SPSO does too. And I don't think, as you say, you can argue that we need to defer it indefinitely. It's been deferred long enough. So I think we're agreed collectively on the various suggestions that have been made. That concludes the open part of the session. We'll be taking the rest of the agenda items in private, and the next meeting will be a week today, unusually, which is our discussion with participants who were on the citizens panel of our public participation inquiry. We'll now move into private session.